Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Higgs, The Invention and Discovery of the God Particle, by Jim Baggott. Narrated by Julian Alpha. Preface. The news that something very much like the Higgs boson had been discovered at CERN in Geneva on the 4th of July 2012 flashed instantaneously around the world like some highly contagious electronic virus. Headlines screamed of this latest triumph of high-energy physics. The discovery made front-page news, was featured in many evening news bulletins, and reached an audience of billions. Signals consistent with a particle that had first been hypothesized or invented in 1964 had at last been found, 48 years later, at a cost of many billions of dollars. So what was all the fuss about? Was it the Higgs boson, and why does it matter so much? If this new particle really is the Higgs, what does it tell us about the material world and the evolution of the early universe? Was finding it really worth all the effort? The answers to these questions can be found in the story of the so-called standard model of particle physics. As the name implies, this is the framework that physicists use to interpret the elementary constituents of all matter and the forces that bind matter together, or cause it to fall apart. It is a body of work built up over many decades of unstinting effort, which represents the physicists' best efforts to interpret the physical world around us. The standard model is not yet a theory of everything. It does not account for the force of gravity. In recent years, you may have heard about exotic new theories of physics which attempt to unify the fundamental forces, including gravity. These are theories such as supersymmetry and superstrings. Despite the efforts of hundreds of theorists engaged on these projects, these new theories remain speculative and have little or no supporting evidence from experiment. For the time being, and despite flaws that have been acknowledged since its inception in the late 1970s, the standard model is still where most of the real action is. The Higgs boson is important in the standard model because it implies the existence of a Higgs field, an otherwise invisible field of energy which pervades the entire universe. Without the Higgs field, the elementary particles that make up you, me, and the visible universe would have no mass. Without the Higgs field, mass could not be constructed, and nothing could be. It seems we owe quite a lot to the existence of this field. This is one of the reasons why the Higgs boson, the particle of the Higgs field, has been hyped in the popular press as the God particle. This is a name heartily despised by practicing scientists, as it overstates the importance of the particle and draws attention to the sometimes uneasy relationship between physics and theology. It is, however, a name much beloved by science journalists and popular science writers. Many of the predicted consequences of the Higgs field were borne out in particle collider experiments in the early 1980s. But inferring the field is not the same as detecting its telltale field particle. It is therefore immensely reassuring to know that the field is very probably here, there, and everywhere. The possibility that the Higgs boson might not have been found was very real, and the implications for the standard model were potentially devastating. I began creating this book in June 2010, 2 years before the discovery was made. I had just completed the manuscript of another book called The Quantum Story, A History in 40 Moments, which, as the title implies, is a history of quantum physics from 1900 to the present day. That book covered the development of the standard model and the invention of the Higgs field and its particle. A few months earlier, CERN's Large Hadron Collider reached record proton-proton collision energies of 7 trillion electron volts, and I figured that a discovery might be possible within the next few years. Happily, I was proved right. The quantum story was published in February 2011. The present book is based in part on that earlier work. Jim Baggott, Reading, the 6th of July 2012. Foreword by Steven Weinberg. Many important scientific discoveries have been followed by popular books explaining these discoveries to the general populace. But this is the first case I have seen of a book that has been largely produced in anticipation of a discovery. The readiness of this book for publication immediately after the announcement in July 2012 of the discovery at CERN, with some corroboration from Fermilab, of a new particle that seems to be the Higgs particle, testifies to the remarkable energy and enterprise of Jim Baggott and Oxford University Press. The prompt publication of this book also testifies to the widespread public interest in this discovery. So it may be worthwhile if, in this foreword, I add some remarks of my own about just what has been accomplished. It is often said that what was at stake in the search for the Higgs particle was the origin of mass. True enough, but this explanation needs some sharpening. By the 1980s, we had a good comprehensive theory of all observed elementary particles and the forces, other than gravitation, that they exert on one another. One of the essential elements of this theory is a symmetry, like a family relationship, between two of these forces, the electromagnetic force and the weak nuclear force. Electromagnetism is responsible for light. The weak nuclear force allows particles inside atomic nuclei to change their identity in radioactive decay processes. This symmetry brings the two forces together in a single electroweak structure. The general features of the electroweak theory have been well tested. Their validity is not what has been at stake in the recent experiments at CERN and Fermilab and would not be seriously in doubt even if no Higgs particle had been discovered. But one of the consequences of the electroweak symmetry is that, if nothing new is added to the theory, all elementary particles, including electrons and quarks, would be massless, which of course they are not. So something has to be added to the electroweak theory, some new kind of matter or field not yet observed in nature or in our laboratories. The search for the Higgs particle has been a search for the answer to the question, what is this new stuff we need? The search for this new stuff has not been just a matter of noodling around at high energy accelerators, waiting to see what turns up. Somehow the electroweak symmetry, an exact property of the underlying equations of elementary particle physics, must be broken. It must not apply directly to the particles and forces we actually observe. It has been known since the work of Yoichiro Nambu and Jeffrey Goldstone in 1960-61 that symmetry breaking of this sort is possible in various theories, but it had seemed that it would necessarily entail new massless particles, which were known not to exist. It was the independent work of Robert Brout and François Engler, Peter Higgs and Gerald Guralnik, Carl Hagen and Tom Kibble, all in 1964, that showed that in some kinds of theories, these massless Nambu-Goldstone particles would disappear, serving only to give mass to force-carrying particles. For brevity, I will refer to this work as the 1964 papers. This is what happens in the theory of weak and electromagnetic forces proposed in 1967-68 by Abdus Salam and myself. But this still left open the question, what sort of new matter or field is actually breaking the electroweak symmetry? There were two possibilities. One possibility was that there are hitherto unobserved fields that pervade empty space, and that just as the Earth's magnetic field distinguishes north from other directions, these new fields distinguish weak from electromagnetic forces, giving mass to the particles that carry the weak force and to other particles, but leaving photons, which carry the electromagnetic force, with zero mass. These are called scalar fields, meaning that unlike magnetic fields, they do not distinguish directions in ordinary space. Scalar fields of this general sort were introduced in the illustrative examples of symmetry breaking used by Goldstone and later in the 1964 papers. When Salam and I used this sort of symmetry breaking in developing the modern electroweak theory of weak and electromagnetic forces, we assumed that the symmetry breaking was due to fields of this scalar type pervading all space. A symmetry of this sort had already been hypothesized by Sheldon Glashow and by Salam and John Ward, but not as an exact property of the equations of the theory, so these theorists were not led to introduce scalar fields. One of the consequences of theories in which symmetries are broken by scalar fields, including the models considered by Goldstone and the 1964 papers and the electroweak theory of Salam and me, is that although some of these fields serve only to give mass to the force-carrying particles, other scalar fields would be manifested in nature as new physical particles that could be created and observed in accelerators and particle colliders. Salam and I found we needed to put four scalar fields into our electroweak theory. Three of these scalar fields were used up in giving mass to the W+, W- and Z boson particles, the heavy photons, that in our theory carry the weak force. These particles were discovered at CERN in 1983-84 and found to have the masses predicted by the electroweak theory. One of the scalar fields was left over to be manifested as a physical particle, a bundle of the energy and momentum of this field. This is the Higgs particle for which physicists have been searching for nearly 30 years. But there was always a second possibility. There might instead be no new scalar fields pervading space and no Higgs particle. Instead, the electroweak symmetry might be broken by strong forces, known as technicolor forces, acting on a new class of particles too heavy to have been observed yet. Something like this happens in superconductivity. This kind of theory of elementary particles was proposed in the late 1970s independently by Leonard Susskind and myself, and would lead to a whole forest of new particles held together by technicolor forces. So this is the alternative with which we have been faced: scalar fields or technicolor. The discovery of the new particle casts a very strong vote in favor of the electroweak symmetry being broken by scalar fields rather than by technicolor forces. This is why the discovery is important. But much remains to be done to pin this down. The electroweak theory of 1967-68 predicted all of the properties of the Higgs particle except its mass. With the mass now known experimentally, we can calculate the probabilities for all the various ways that Higgs particles can decay and see if these predictions are borne out by further experiment. This will take a while. The discovery of a new particle that appears to be the Higgs also leaves theorists with a difficult task: to understand its mass. The Higgs is the one elementary particle whose mass does not arise from the breakdown of the electroweak symmetry. As far as the underlying principles of the electroweak theory are concerned, the Higgs mass could have any value. This is why neither Salam nor I could predict it. In fact, there is something puzzling about the Higgs mass we now do observe. It is generally known as the hierarchy problem. Since it is the Higgs mass that sets the scale for the masses of all other known elementary particles, one might guess that it should be similar to another mass that plays a fundamental role in physics, the so-called Planck mass, which is the fundamental unit of mass in the theory of gravitation. It is the mass of hypothetical particles whose gravitational attraction for each other would be as strong as the electric force between two electrons separated by the same distance. But the Planck mass is about 100,000 trillion times larger than the Higgs mass. So although the Higgs particle is so heavy that a giant particle collider was needed to create it, we still have to ask, why is the Higgs mass so small? Jim Baggott suggested that I might add here some personal perspectives about the evolution of ideas in this field. I'll mention just two points. As Baggett describes in Chapter 4, Philip Anderson argued early, before 1964, that massless Nambu Goldstone particles were not a necessary consequence of symmetry breaking. So why were I and other particle theorists not convinced by Anderson's argument? It certainly did not reflect any judgment that Anderson did not have to be taken seriously. Of all the theorists who concerned themselves with condensed matter physics, no one has seen more clearly than Anderson the importance of principles of symmetry, principles that have proved all important in particle physics. I think that Anderson's argument was generally discounted because it was based on analogies with phenomena like superconductivity, which are non-relativistic, i.e., these are phenomena that occur in domains in which Einstein's special theory of relativity can be safely ignored. But the inevitability of massless Nambu Goldstone particles had been shown, apparently rigorously, by Goldstone, Salam, and me in a 1962 proof that relied on the manifest validity of relativity theory. Particle theorists were prepared to believe that Anderson was right in the non-relativistic context of superconductivity, but not in elementary particle theory, which necessarily incorporates relativity. The work of the 1964 papers made it clear that the proof by Goldstone, Salam, and myself did not apply to quantum theories with force-carrying particles, because although physical phenomena in such theories do satisfy the principle of relativity, the mathematical formulation of these theories in the context of quantum mechanics does not. This problem with relativity was also the reason I was unable, after 1967, despite strenuous efforts, to prove what Salam and I had conjectured, that nonsensical infinities that appeared in the electroweak theory all cancelled out, in the same way that similar infinities had already been shown to cancel in the quantum theory of electromagnetism alone. Relativity had been essential in demonstrating the cancellation of infinities in electromagnetism. The proof of cancellation by Gerhard de Hooft in 1971, described by Baggott in Chapter 5, used techniques that de Hooft had worked out with Martinus Veltmann, in which the principles of quantum mechanics are stretched to allow the theory to be formulated in a way that is consistent with relativity. A second point. Baggott suggests in Chapter 4 that I did not include quarks in my 1967 paper proposing the electroweak theory, because I was concerned about the problem that the theory might predict processes involving so-called strange particles that were not in fact observed. I wish that my reason had been that specific. Rather, I did not include quarks in the theory simply because in 1967 I just did not believe in quarks. No one had ever observed a quark, and it was hard to believe that this was because quarks are much heavier than observed particles like protons and neutrons, when these observed particles were supposed to be made of quarks. Like many other theorists, I did not fully accept the existence of quarks until the 1973 work of David Gross and Frank Wilczek and David Politzer. They showed that in the theory of quarks and strong nuclear forces known as quantum chromodynamics, the strong force gets weaker with decreasing distance. It then occurred to some of us that in that case, the strong force between quarks would counterintuitively get stronger as the quarks get farther apart, perhaps so much so as to prevent quarks from ever being separated from one another. There still is no proof of this, but it is generally believed. Quantum chromodynamics is by now a very well-tested theory, and yet no one has ever seen an isolated quark. I was very glad that this book began in the early 20th century with Emmy Noether, who realized before anyone else the importance of symmetry principles in nature. This helps to remind us that the work of scientists today is just the latest step in a grand tradition of trying to guess how nature works, always subjecting our guesses to the test of experiment. Jim Baggott's book should give the listeners some of the flavor of this historic enterprise. Stephen Weinberg, 6th of July, 2012. Prologue. Form and Substance. What is the world made of? Simple questions such as this have been teasing the human intellect for as long as humankind has been capable of rational thought. For sure, the way we ask this question today has become much more elaborate and sophisticated, and the answers have become much more complex and costly to provide. But make no mistake, at heart the question remains a very simple one. 2,500 years ago, all the ancient Greek philosophers had to go on was their sense of beauty and harmony in nature, and their powers of logical reasoning and imagination applied to the things they could perceive with their unaided senses. With hindsight, it is quite extraordinary just how much they were able to figure out. The Greeks were careful to distinguish between form and substance. The world is made of material substance, which can take a variety of different forms. The 5th century BC Sicilian philosopher Empedocles suggested that this variety could be reduced to four basic forms, what we know today as classical elements. These were earth, air, fire, and water. The elements were judged to be eternal and indestructible, joined together in rather romantic combinations through the attractive force of love and split apart through the repulsive force of strife, to make up everything in the world. Another school of thought, originating with the 5th century BC philosopher Leucippus, and most closely associated with his pupil Democritus, held that the world consists of tiny, indivisible, indestructible material particles, called atoms, and empty space, void. The atoms represented the building blocks of all material substance responsible for all matter. Atoms were necessary as a matter of principle, so Leucippus argued, because substance surely could not be divided indefinitely. If this were possible, then we would be able to divide substance endlessly into nothing, in apparent contradiction with what seemed to be an unassailable law of the conservation of matter. About a century later, Plato developed a theory which explained how atoms, the substance, are attracted to make up the four elements, the forms. He represented each of the four elements by a geometrical or platonic solid and argued in the Timaeus that the faces of each solid could be further decomposed into systems of triangles, representing the elements' constituent atoms. Rearrange the patterns of triangles, rearrange the atoms, and it was possible to convert one element into another and combine elements to produce new forms. It seems logical that there should be some ultimate constituents, some undeniable reality that underpins the world we see around us and which lends it form and shape. If matter is endlessly divisible, then we would reach a point where the constituents themselves become rather ephemeral, to the point of non-existence. Then there would be no building blocks, and all we would be left with are interactions between indefinable, insubstantial phantoms which give rise to the appearance of substance. Unpalatable it may be, but to a large extent, this is precisely what modern physics has shown to be true. Mass, we now believe, is not an inherent property or primary quality of the ultimate building blocks of nature. In fact, there is no such thing as mass. Mass is constructed entirely from the energy of interactions involving naturally massless elementary particles. The physicist kept dividing and in the end found nothing at all. It was not until the development of a formal experimental philosophy in the early 17th century that it became possible to transcend the kind of speculative thinking that had characterized the theories of the ancient Greeks. The old philosophy had tried to intuit the nature of material substance from observations contaminated with prejudices about how the world ought to be. The new scientists now tinkered with nature itself, teasing out evidence about how the world really is. The questions were still primarily concerned with the nature of form and substance. The concept of mass, a measure of the amount of matter as manifested in the dynamical movements of objects, became central to our understanding of substance. An object's resistance to acceleration is interpreted as inertial mass. When kicked with the same force, a small object will accelerate much faster than a large one. An object's ability to generate a gravitational field is interpreted as gravitational mass. The force of gravity generated by the moon is weaker than the force generated by the Earth, because the moon is smaller and so possesses a smaller gravitational mass. Inertial and gravitational mass are empirically identical, although there is no compelling theoretical reason why this should be so. The scientists also exposed the secrets of nature's great variety of form. The fundamental Greek element, water, was found to consist not of geometrical solids composed of triangles, as Plato had surmised, but of molecules composed of atoms of the chemical elements hydrogen and oxygen in a combination we write today as H2O. This more modern use of the word atom initially evoked the interpretation lent to it by the Greeks as an indivisible building block of matter. But even as the reality of atoms was being hotly debated, in 1897, English physicist Joseph John Thomson was discovering the negatively charged electron. It seemed that atoms, in their turn, possessed constituent, subatomic parts. Thomson's discovery was followed in the years 1909-11 by experiments in the Manchester laboratory of New Zealander Ernest Rutherford. These experiments showed that atoms consist for the most part of empty space. At the center of the atom sits a tiny, positively charged nucleus, around which the negatively charged electrons orbit, much like planets orbit the sun. Most of the mass of the atoms that make up the elements of material substance is concentrated in their atomic nuclei. It is therefore in the nucleus that form and substance come together. This planetary model of the atom remains a compelling visual metaphor even today, but it was immediately obvious to the physicists of the time that such a model actually makes no sense. Such planetary atoms were expected to be inherently unstable. Unlike planets moving around the sun, electrically charged particles moving in an electric field radiate energy in the form of electromagnetic waves. Such planetary electrons would exhaust their energy within a fraction of a second, and the internal architecture of the atom would then collapse. The solution to this particular puzzle emerged in the guise of quantum mechanics in the early 1920s. The electron is not just a particle, which we might visualize as a tiny ball of negatively charged matter. It is simultaneously both wave and particle. It is not here or there, as might be expected of a localized bit of stuff, but literally everywhere within the confines of its ghostly, delocalized wave function. Electrons do not orbit the nucleus as such. Instead, their wave functions form characteristic three-dimensional patterns, which we call orbitals, in the space around the nucleus. The mathematical form of each orbital relates the probability of finding the now wholly mysterious electron at specific locations, here or there, inside the atom. The quantum revolution was a time of unprecedented fertility in both theoretical and experimental physics. When in 1927 English physicist Paul Dirac combined quantum mechanics with Albert Einstein's special theory of relativity, out popped a new property called electron spin. This was a property already known to experimentalists and tentatively interpreted in terms of an electron spinning on its axis like a spinning top, much as the Earth rotates on its axis as it orbits the Sun. But this was another visual metaphor that was quickly found to have no foundation in reality. Today we interpret electron spin as a purely relativistic quantum effect, in which electrons may take up one of two possible orientations, which we call spin up and spin down. These are not orientations along specific directions in conventional three-dimensional space, but orientations in a spin space, which has only two dimensions, up or down. Each orbital in an atom was found to contain two, and only two, electrons. This is Austrian physicist Wolfgang Pauli's famous exclusion principle, which he developed in 1925 and which states that electrons are forbidden from occupying the same quantum state. The principle derives from the mathematical form of the wave function for any composite state consisting of two or more electrons. If the composite state were assumed to be created with two electrons which have precisely the same physical characteristics, then the wave function has zero amplitude. Such a state could not exist. For the wave function to exist with a non-zero amplitude, then the two electrons must somehow be different. In an atomic orbital, this means that one electron must have a spin-up orientation and one must have a spin-down orientation. In other words, their spins must be paired. It is wise to resist the temptation to imagine what these different orientations might actually look like. Their effects are real enough, however. Spin determines the amount of angular momentum carried by the electron, the momentum associated with the rotational motion of its spin. Spin also governs how the electron interacts with a magnetic field, effects that can be studied in detail in the laboratory. But in quantum mechanics, we appear to have crossed the threshold between what we can know of the origin of these effects and what we cannot. Dirac's relativistic quantum theory of the electron also yielded up twice as many solutions as he thought he had needed. Two of the solutions correspond to the spin-up and spin-down orientations of the electron. So what did the other two solutions correspond to? He had some ideas of his own, but finally conceded in 1931 that they had to represent the spin-up and spin-down orientations of a previously unknown positive electron. Dirac had discovered antimatter. The positron, the antiparticle of the electron, was subsequently found in experiments on cosmic rays formed high in the Earth's atmosphere by collisions involving high-energy particles. In 1932, it seemed that the final piece of the puzzle had been found. English physicist James Chadwick discovered the neutron, an electrically neutral particle which sits snugly alongside the positively charged proton inside the atomic nucleus. It seemed that physicists now had all the ingredients to formulate a definitive answer to our opening question. The answer went something like this. All the material substance in the world is made up of chemical elements. These elements come in a great variety of forms which make up the periodic table, from the lightest, hydrogen, to the heaviest known, naturally occurring element, uranium. There are elements heavier than uranium, but these do not occur in nature. They are inherently unstable and must therefore be produced artificially in a laboratory or a nuclear reactor. Plutonium is perhaps the best known example. Each element consists of atoms. Each atom consists of a nucleus composed of varying numbers of positively charged protons and electrically neutral neutrons. Each element is characterized by the number of protons in the nuclei of its atoms. Hydrogen has 1, helium 2, lithium 3, and so on to uranium, which has 92. Surrounding the nucleus are negatively charged electrons, in numbers which balance the numbers of protons, so that overall the atom is electrically neutral. Each electron can take either a spin-up or spin-down orientation, and each orbital can accommodate two electrons provided their spins are paired. It is a very comprehensive answer. With fundamental building blocks of protons, neutrons, and electrons, and Pauli's exclusion principle, we can explain why the periodic table has the structure that it has. We can explain why matter has shape and density. We can explain the existence of isotopes. Atoms with the same numbers of protons but different numbers of neutrons in their nuclei. With a little effort, we can explain all of chemistry, biochemistry, and materials science. In this description, mass is no real mystery. The mass of all material substance can be traced back to its constituent protons and neutrons, which account for about 99% of the mass of every atom. Imagine a small cube of ice formed from triply distilled water. Its sides measure 2.7 centimeters in length, or a little over an inch. Pick it up. It's cold and slippery. It's not heavy, but you are conscious of its weight in the palm of your hand. So where does the mass of the ice cube reside? The molecular weight of water is simply calculated from the total number of protons and neutrons in the nuclei of the two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen that make up H2O. The nucleus of each hydrogen atom consists of just one proton, and the nucleus of the oxygen atom contains 8 protons and 8 neutrons, making 18 nucleons in total. The cube of pure ice you hold in your hand will weigh about 18 grams, equal to the molecular weight in grams. The cube therefore represents a standard measure of solid water known as a mole. We know that a mole of substance contains a fixed number of the atoms or molecules that make up that substance. This is Avogadro's number, a little over 600 billion trillion, 6 times 10 to the 23rd power. Here then is the answer. The weight of the ice cube that you feel in the palm of your hand is the combined result of the masses of 600 billion trillion molecules of H2O, or about 10,800 billion trillion protons and neutrons. It had to be accepted that atoms were no longer indestructible, as the Greeks had once thought. Atoms could be transmuted, turned from one form into another. In 1905, Einstein had used his special theory of relativity to show that mass and energy are equivalent through what was to become the world's most famous scientific equation, E equals mc squared. Energy is equal to mass multiplied by the speed of light squared. However, far from undermining the concept of mass, the notion that mass represents a vast reservoir of energy somehow made it even more substantial. Substantial but not immutable. Einstein showed that matter, mass, is not conserved, it can be converted to energy. When an atom of uranium-235 is fissioned by bombardment with a fast neutron, about one-fifth of the mass of a single proton is converted into energy in the resulting nuclear reaction. When scaled up to a 56-kilogram bomb core of 90% pure uranium-235, the amount of mass energy released was sufficient to destroy utterly the Japanese city of Hiroshima in August 1945. But Einstein was actually chasing a deeper truth. There was a clue in the title of his 1905 paper. Does the inertia of a body depend on its energy content? Einstein had understood that E equals mc squared really means that m equals e over c squared. All inertial mass is just another form of energy. In fact, the equation E equals mc squared does not appear in this form in Einstein's paper. The profound implications of this observation would not become apparent for another 60 years. By the mid-1930s, fundamental building blocks of protons, neutrons, and electrons seemed to provide a comprehensive answer to our opening question. But there was a problem. It had been known since the late 19th century that isotopes of certain elements are unstable. They are radioactive. Their nuclei disintegrate spontaneously in a series of nuclear reactions. There are different kinds of radioactivity. One kind, which was called beta radioactivity by Rutherford in 1899, involves the transformation of a neutron in a nucleus into a proton accompanied by the ejection of a high-speed electron, a beta particle. This is a natural form of alchemy. Changing the number of protons in the nucleus necessarily changes its chemical identity. Beta radioactivity implied that the neutron is an unstable composite particle and so not really fundamental at all. There was also a problem with the balance of energy in this process. The theoretical energy released by the transformation of a proton inside the nucleus could not all be accounted for by the energy of the emitted electron. In 1930, Pauli had felt that he had no choice but to propose that the energy missing in the reaction was being carried away by an as yet unobserved, light, electrically neutral particle which eventually came to be called a neutrino, small neutral one. At the time, it was judged that it would be impossible to detect such a particle, but it was first discovered in 1956. It was time to take stock. This much was clear. Matter relies on force to hold it together. Aside from the force of gravity, which acts universally on all matter, there were now judged to be three other kinds of force at play within the atom itself. The interactions between electrically charged particles are derived from the force of electromagnetism, well known from the pioneering work of 19th century physicists, which, among many notable achievements, laid the foundations for the power industry. A fully relativistic quantum theory of the electromagnetic field, called quantum electrodynamics, QED, was worked out in 1948 by American physicists Richard Feynman and Julian Schwinger, and Japanese physicist Shin-Ichiro Tomonaga. In QED, the forces of attraction and repulsion between electrically charged particles are carried by so-called force particles. For example, as two electrons approach each other, they exchange a force particle which causes them to be repelled. The force carrier of the electromagnetic field is the photon, the quantum particle which makes up ordinary light. QED was quickly established as a theory of unprecedented predictive power. There were yet another two forces to contend with. Electromagnetism could not explain how protons and neutrons bind together inside atomic nuclei, nor could it explain the interactions associated with beta radioactive decay. These interactions work at such different energy scales that no single force can accommodate both. It was recognized that two forces were needed: a strong nuclear force responsible for holding atomic nuclei together, and a weak nuclear force governing certain nuclear transformations. This brings us to the period in the history of physics to be described in this book. A further 60 years of theoretical and experimental particle physics have brought us to the Standard Model, a collection of fundamental quantum field theories which describe all matter and all the forces between material particles, with the exception of gravity. The easiest way to appreciate what the Standard Model is and what it means for our understanding of the material world is to take a quick tour through its history. Our journey begins in 1915 in the quiet German university town of Göttingen. Part 1. Invention.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.